line than one is that you're okay with statism, which is slavery. And that's utter slavery for a man, regardless of the arbitrary rule, to take property from another man without his consent. You're saying that's slavery, and you're okay with slavery.
Oh, I'm saying you give implied consent when you go out on the public roads. You give implied consent that you are going to follow the rules of the road.
Says who?
Okay, so back to the question. What implied consent is given?
Exactly. That's why I've gone on my story. So I want to listen. The guy who is defending.
Implied consent happens when you leave your driveway and hit the public roads. That it, you are implying that you consent to the rules of those public roads.
So here's the problem. Wow.
Another very common anti-libertarian cliche is the idea of a social contract. What does this even mean? I'm not sure I've ever heard two people invoke the concept of a social contract on the same grounds. As best as I can tell, it's just an empty bromide that people vomit up as soon as their beliefs are confronted with clear logical and moral contradictions, which means that naturally, anarchists hear this one a lot. The fundamental basis of a social contract, to the degree that it can be defined at all, is that we benefit from living in society, in contrast to living in isolation. So we are obligated to do things for the benefit of the rest of society. This can imply all kinds of things, obviously. It can mean paying taxes. It can mean jury duty. It might mean silently going to forced labor camps. After all, that was just the Jewish obligation to the rest of Nazi society, right? This isn't a straw man argument either. When Thomas Hobbes first came up with the notion of a social contract, he openly acknowledged that the ruling class had rights that we plebeians don't. And if the government commits acts of violence, it cannot, by definition, be unjust. This is original social contract theory in a nutshell. Of course, social contract parrots will deny that this is what the glorified social contract actually entails. But how do we know that it doesn't obligate concentration camps, gulags, and genocide? By which, of course, we mean voluntary suicide as per the social contract of the democratic process. We don't actually know what the social contract obligates. You know why? Because it doesn't exist. Most invocations of the social contract are for obligations that have never been written down or codified in any way that resembles a contract in any meaningful sense. The closest thing we have to a social contract is a written constitution, but there's even problems with this one. Not only did no single person alive sign the constitution, but even if we were to accept that our wise overlords can bind third parties to a contract without their consent, constitutions bind both the government and the people, and the government violates their end of the contract every single day. So if I were to accept the Constitution as a social contract, it would have been nullified before the Washington presidency was over. The reality is that when people say you have to abide by a social contract, what they really mean is that you, the undersigned, must conform to their preferred modes of behavior. So stop complaining about the gulags, everybody. Those people were just upholding their socially contractual obligations to the rest of their Soviet comrades.
And then I saved my favorite one for last, the social contract.
The social contract is another one of the best excuses that tyrants have to commit violence. Again, it has a lot to do with, it goes along with the notion of voting, where it's like, you consented to this, only the social contract is even more bizarre because it basically says, well, by falling out of your mom on this piece of dirt, that counts as you agreeing for the rest of your life to be subjected to the arbitrary whims of the ruling class over in D.C. It's just so patently stupid. And the funny thing is, it gives away a huge collectivist mentality and status, because what they're really saying is that they believe the politicians in D.C. own every square inch of this country, quote unquote. Because if they didn't, like, I don't get to say, hey, by living in your own house, you're agreeing to give me $100 a week. Like, what? No, you don't get to do that unless it's your house. So it really is people saying that they think the politicians own everything, and that us being on the politicians' property agreeing to go along with anything they say. And it's that bad. And then I wrote a thing not that long ago pointing out, if you accept that premise, then there's no such thing as unalienable rights anymore. Because if they own it, they can make up any damn rules they want. They can say, give us all your money or leave the country. What would the statist objection be to that if he believes in the social contract, this magic thing you never agreed to? Well, if tomorrow politicians say, give us all your stuff or get out of the country, according to the social contract theory, that's perfectly legitimate. And we're all just all the way slaves or leave the continent.
Hey everybody, it's Tom Woods, August 7th, 2012. I just wanted to answer very briefly a common argument you get on the internet from the man on the street and so on, to the effect that if you libertarians don't like our system and you don't like the rules and why don't you pack up and leave, you have implicitly agreed to abide by the rules and so if you don't like them, you might as well scram and all that. Now, I don't think that's a particularly strong argument, but you get it a lot, so I wanted to take it on. Now, my first response, my instinctive response is, why should I leave? Why should I be the one who has to leave? Why is the moral burden on me when, in fact, you're the one with the gun? I'm the peaceful person. You're the one wielding a gun who wants to expropriate me and then use the proceeds to fund drone strikes. It would seem to me that a healthy moral reckoning would have it that you would have to demonstrate your right to do that before I would have to demonstrate my right to sit here unmolested. So that'd be the first point. But then also the idea that my mere presence somewhere indicates my consent to the system is highly problematic. And that is what they're saying. They're saying, you're here after all, so you have to agree to the rules. Just by being here, you've automatically consented to the rules. That's clearly not the case. As my friend Roderick Long puts it, suppose your neighbor starts dumping garbage on your lawn. Does that, and you don't move away right away. You stay in that house. Does that mean, the fact that you're staying in the house and you don't immediately move, does that mean that you've consented to the garbage being dumped on your lawn and it should just continue to go on and that would be just? Well, obviously not. And now continuing with some arguments that Roderick has made, which I think are very helpful. He's a professor of philosophy at Auburn. When people talk about my agreeing to abide by the rules, well, the issue is, depends on the moral status and the legal status of the lawmaker. So, for example, suppose I have you over to my house, and you come in the door, and I say to you, you have to wear the funny hat. And this may seem odd to you, and I say, but you're in my house, these are the rules. Well, it's an odd rule, but you're in my house, I can make the rules. What you can't do is say, well, I'm going to stay in your house and not wear the funny hat. These are my rules. Now, on the other hand, suppose I come to your house, and I knock on your door, and when you come to the door, I say to you, you have to wear the funny hat. Well, then you would have every right in the world to say, now, wait a minute. When did I agree to wear the funny hat? You would not accept as an explanation, well, you know, you moved in next door to me, so that implicitly, you were implicitly giving your consent to wearing the hat. Even though right to my face, you are telling me you don't want to wear the hat, your implicit mystical consent by moving in the general area of my hat indicated your consent to the funny hat system. No one would accept that. There's no part of our lives in which we would accept implicit, hypothetical, tacit sort of consent. We would never accept this. As usual, government has its own rules that it abides by, that no one else, no one in private life would agree to a system like that. So when people say to you, by being here, you have automatically consented to the rules, they're begging the whole question. They're assuming the very thing that's supposed to be proven. They're totally overlooking the distinction in the funny hat example between the guy who had the right to tell you to wear the funny hat, you could leave if you didn't want to, and the case in which he didn't have the right to tell you to wear the funny hat. It depends on, is he legitimately exercising jurisdiction? Well, over his own property, he is. But over your property, he isn't. Well, the you have automatically agreed to abide by the rules crowd just totally ignores the question of, is the lawgiver justly in power? Does he own this property? Did he properly come to exercise this power? None of these moral questions are even considered. They're all just simply ignored and glided over. Then we're told that we use the government systems. I drive on the roads, I use the post office or whatever, and so that means, therefore, I've consented to be expropriated and have the funds used for drone strikes. But here, again, this is a problem. The mere fact that I inescapably use systems that I have services that I have no choice but to use does not indicate consent, any more than the fact that I might eat a meal in prison indicates my consent to imprisonment. No, this whole argument of implicit consent, tacit consent, all this is all just a pathetic smokescreen to conceal the fact that my actual words and my actual views are in the form of dissent. And my actual words of, I don't consent to this, are supposed to be somehow overridden by this mystical tacit consent that I didn't even know I was engaging in by the mere fact of standing in some place. This is a ridiculous argument that's advanced by people who simply want to wield power. And then after the fact, they come up with this crummy rationalization to try to make it seem as if I really want to be ruled. I implicitly crave being ruled. I've implicitly consented to being ruled. I don't implicitly do any of this. I explicitly say, no, I do not consent to this.
But whether the Constitution really be one thing or another, this much is certain, that it is either authorized such a government as we have had, or has been powerless to prevent it. In either case, it is unfit to exist.